Hello, ladies and gents, boys and girls. My name is Oswald Lyric Vividar, and welcome to my walkthrough on Transocean Shipping Company. So I've got this one going in, and in the new year I'll be covering the ultimate guide, which is my ultimate challenge guide, which is something that I was doing a couple of weeks ago but ended up taking down. So what we're going to do, we're going to start a new game. We're going to cover the campaign on easy mode, and then we're going to do the ultimate guide. And in that, we're going to basically do a lot of different things. So this is just basically taking you over how to play the game, how to set up, and blah, 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 blah. I might do a hard version of the game, but I'm not too sure yet. So first things first, we need to create a name. Then we need to get a colour for our banner. Let's put in a new one for which is this one. And I want, yeah, that'll be. We'll mirror it. And then we'll get a nice colour on the ground before we get it. Right, so first things first, I need to explain a few things. So basically, you've got little locations. So you'll probably be looking at all of these thinking, what the fuck are that? Right, so these are all ports. They come in class from 1 to 5. Now, one, and specifically being because each different port can host a different type of ship, or a different class of ships. So obviously this bottle cap looking thing is, and there is only one in the start area, there's only a handful of them in the entire game. So the bottle cap is a class 1 port, which basically only allows feeders to dock there. Then you have this symbol here, which is almost like, I don't know what to really describe it as, but anyway, this little symbol here that's highlighted over Dublin, they're class 2 ports. So there's Dublin, there's Stockholm, and there's Algiers, and also Lisbon. Then you've got the class 3 port, which is Hamburg and St. Peter's. And then you've got class 4 ports, which you won't see until later on in the game. And then you've got class 5 ports, which are Valencia, Flexdale, Rotterdam, Laboratoria, whatever the hell that is, and Port Said. So, yeah, I mean, they're the different types of ports. So obviously, each different type of port can hold a different, can create a different type of ship. And also, these class 5 ports in the starting area literally give you no global bonuses, so be aware of that. So each different class, so you've got the feeders, Panamax, post-Panamax, new Panamax, and then the ULCVs. Now the ULCVs are massive and they can't go through the Panama Canal. That's basically what it is. So Panamax is the first class of ship that can go through it. The Panama Canal is basically a stretch of water that has to be flooded in order for the ship to be able to pass through. It then got extended and then extended again for obviously post-Panamax, new Panamax. But the ULCVs are too big to go through, so you basically have to go around. And this is one of the reasons why I recommend not bothering even purchasing them types of ships, because they're just pointless. You just don't make enough profit, even in an easy game, you don't really make enough profit out of them. They're just not profitable to use. So we're only going to be using 4 types of ship anyway, so it's really not going to bother us. But we do need to pick a starting point. Now, my suggestion would be to start with Reykjavik, and there's a reason behind that. If you're playing a hard game, you would really want Reykjavik as a starting point. Now, because of the tugger systems. Now, it's all very well you saying, oh yeah, but I can just, you know, dry dock myself. But that's a lot of time and energy when you've got, let's say, 50 ships. going in and out of courts every 2 minutes or so. And you'll be there playing the game all day and day, and it does get boring. Eventually, you're just going to go, fuck it, I'll play 2 points. So Reykjavik is pretty much a no-brainer because you get 20% minus on top assistance. You also get a 20% discount on subsidiary costs. So, you know, if a subsidiary costs you 50 million, it will cost you 40 million. And you also make a 20% bonus on post and parcel contracts, which are pretty much, it is pretty much the main contract that you're going to be using throughout the game. So Reykjavik is pretty much the go-to for especially starting. You can pick like whichever one you want, but that's pretty much where I would start myself. With Dublin, you get 10% on ship sale prices and minus 5% on repair costs. It's not really worth the value. Hamburg is 25% duration, less on duration of repair, which can be quite handy, especially in a hard mode game. But again, over what you get out of Reykjavik, it's really a no-brainer to go with Reykjavik. Stockholm, minus 10% on contractual penalties and minus 2% on loan interest rates. Again, there isn't really much benefit in that, so again, it comes down to Reykjavik. St. Peter's, 10% on alcoholic beverage contract prices. Again, no-brainer for Reykjavik. Lisbon is 5% on fuel in price. Now, fuel you're going to use a lot of. Now, that is one thing that I would say that is a lot. But 5% on all contract prices, you're not really going to see a value out of that, unfortunately, for me as a whole. I mean, when we're talking about massive ships going into port at, say, 400,000 per ton, and then leaving at 400,000 per ton, I mean, you get 20% discount on that, and that's going to, you know, you're going to see more benefit from Reykjavik again. Argos to 5% on metal prices and minus 10% on improvement costs. Again, the improvement cost is pretty good, but again, Reykjavik is still standing out for me. So I would strongly recommend just going with Reykjavik. And I've given you the options to pick for yourself and try them out. I mean, each go around, it may work for you to pick a different location, but I would strongly recommend for Reykjavik. And this is where I'm going to start the guide anyway. So if you want to follow on the guide, I would start Reykjavik first time around. And you may just like it, but I've fallen in love with it. Normally I would pick Flexdale because again I'm from England and Flexdale is just the one I went for. But then when I started doing the guide, I noticed the global advantages and I thought, ooh, okay. And I tried it out and I fell in love. So I'm going to pick Reykjavik. I'm once we've hit Stockholm, we're going to bring the ship in for a cab. We just want to make some money. And then all you do is you just put the bus on and speak down. So we're going to use the with assistance throughout the game because it saves time. The structure to to Stockholm. Obviously we're playing in these contract penalties quite low, but I want to get you into the game rather than not, so I don't want to jump straight into a hard game because it does get really hard, and it's a lot of difference between the game and easy to hard. So to bear that in mind when you play a game, I would strongly recommend playing easy, then go to medium, and then go to hard, because hard is it's really difficult. You've got to take into consideration that fuel prices and where to top up fuel. And I've done personally, but that's because I've pretty much not had to play the game. And you know, for me, I've got a bit of experience and I know what to buy and what not to buy, and what to pick up, what not to pick up, and how far to port, so I kind of make it there, so blah blah blah. So, because obviously I've got a load of experience behind it. So, it can get quite intense at times. So we've just arrived in port, we've now got 6 points. Still gives me 7 points. As you see, it's now the 24th. We worked out it was going to be the 23rd because it was going to take 4 days to get there and then another 6 days to get to Reykjavik. Obviously, you know, considering always accountability for an extra day. So if you're doing multiple journeys, I would add an extra day in between those. And if you're doing, like, say, three contracts at once and you're going to three different locations, I'd add an extra 2 days to the order, just to be on the safe side, because you need to take into consideration docking time, etc, etc. So, I'm obviously reading the book. Thank you. very strange. Very strange. I've eaten a whole packet of biscuits today, and it almost hasn't done anything to my belly. I suffer with acid reflux, right? And I'm pretty much allergic to everything that's got a bit of fat in it. And I've eaten a whole packet of cookies today, and it's done absolutely nothing to my belly. It's like, what on earth? I don't get that. Yet if I pick up, it's got palm in it as well, which usually I go at with. But I'm fine. It's just unusual that I'm not in absolute agony, and I haven't got reflux. So I'm starting to think that most of it's actually in my head. But no reflux for me, I'm happy. So let's see. One of the products that I would try to avoid transportating is the beans and buns. So this shit here is just not worth transportating. There's a reason behind it. It's just not worth the money. And for me, I've just never seen a great value. And people want to have this stuff for you'll probably find that we get pulled over by customers. You'll have to bear with me, I can't really read that well, sadly. It's unfortunate. And Bali, Lee, Nana, Lee, Nana. You're probably giggling your tits off at that, I'm trying to do what school taught me to do, I break it down into like syllables. So for me, I'm anybody, Lee Man Boy. Yeah, okay, we'll forget that one. Let's get Google to read it back to me so I can see. Let's just see what Google is like. Amberley. Okay, so I've just got a town in England. A village in England. Okay, thank you very much. Amberley. A college. Amberley again, okay, Google the useless. Oh, fucking hell, though. Google, you're funny. Ambali. Limanari. Turkey. Okay. No, it's not. Port in Istanbul. Okay. Oh, you learn something new every day. How to say Ambali Limanari? What? That's all I wanted, Google. Thank you very much. Sorry about that. Port Said. I think it actually might be Port Said. Is for us to make enough money to cover ourselves. So, I mean, the next ships after this is Marseille, which has got 2.7 miles, 12 miles. Not a bad ship, really like 10.7 million pounds a day. This is me trying to prove a point about my little hack, that's the sale, for us at the cheap, it's a little hack in game that you can do when you get pulled over by. You can make some really good profit out of it, but just know that you are losing reputation if you do drop the money. It's not a lot of profit, but it's just being a lot of money. How to hack it. So basically, I'll show you very quickly. You go to load again, you have autosave. So every time you leave the port, you'll get an autosave. And all you have to do is just reload your autosave. And that's for really anything that happens when game is back. So that could be, you know, your ship's being taken over by pirates, you've gone for a reef, your ship's burning. Medical problem, thunder and lightning, you know, that's it slows you down in the long run. So if it happens to you, just reload the check. Is just have a look at our sale figures. So in the first month we made 6.2, in the next month we made 4.7, and so far we've made 6.2. So we're on 17 million at the moment, so it should only be because they're a pain in the arse. I mean, it's going to bring my ship down for a couple of days, which we don't really want when we're so close to getting bulky. I just want to make the money, buy a bulky, and then make money. And be warned, this stuff does actually get entirely fucking annoying. It's why I actually bought the entire video series down, because I spent the first few hours swearing my face off, and because of how annoying it really is. It gets even worse in a hard mode game, so just we're on the 24th at the moment. I'm not going to bother buying one. I'm going to do it in the next month, because then I've got bulky to make money straight away. And they're really profitable little ships, so you will make a lot of money from the do tend to get quite a fair. So we're now in the middle of the month, so I'm going to go ahead and go through. And what I normally do is pick up my money, and then go through, and then and since it's already finished, so I'm going to make a difference. So do when you get to Reykjavik. She's going to start hammering you for money. You'll notice that you're getting massive pop-ups saying that she's going to start taking money off you. And if you don't have a ship before that happens, you are going to struggle financially to get the ship. So, and obviously at the moment you'll see that I'm now balanced wise minus 19.8 million. So I've got until the end of the month to get that balance back into the group. Yeah, no, it's stupid, but you know, you've got to take into consideration that it's done over the month. So it's three consecutive months, it's gone quarterly. So over 3 months, if you've been in the red three times, you're going to get hammered on the reputation. Whereas only if you have two green months, it's good. If you get one green month, bad. So nothing and one, bad, two, three is good. So you really want to stay in the green at all times. So buy your ships in the first of the month, so you've got 30 days to make money. It's why I never do the upgrade until the end of the month as well, especially on brand new ships. So I tend to bring a ship down at the end of the month because I know where to put the funds to actually. So the idea being is I want to be able to get my 20 million back. I've got 40 is another way of getting around this as well. So if you really wanted to, you could get a loan and that, you know, just pay it off in the new month. And that's exactly what I'm going to do now. So I'm going to cover myself for an £11 million loan. That will just see me through. So it's put me in the green. It stops me from going. So we're now in the next month and we're already £364,000 in debt. It's no problem. We made £5.7 million last month. We've got £30 million in the bank. So all I'm going to do is I'm just going to go down and clear the loan off. So all I've got to do now is make £11.9 million. Specifically, we need to obviously get the next rank so that we can unlock the next mission. And also the fact that, you know, not being rude, but the pumping contracts are not too bad, but they can be a bit of a pain in the ass to use. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to pick this Venencia order. I can do that with my bulky, which is already on the way around that area. I need just one contract to go up a rank. And that rank then unlocks some things that will specifically make me at the moment. So it's a no-brainer to go up the rank because then you can start working on the next rank itself. I would not buy another bulky just yet, but I will wait until the following month. Talking at the pizza. Nice though. It's 220 you fucking retard. Shut up. Company contract is going through now. Once it's been delivered, I'll open up the bill. So that's a no brainer. I'll open up the bill and I'll also open up radioactive material. So I really want to put a double on. Step three, you don't really need to worry until you basically open the floor map, which you're not going to get until you complete. If I remember right, it's the hamburger. Yes, hamburger. So the hamburger. So we've got that to move out, so we're now 0.6, 7, whatever that says. And this is where you get awarded your first mate contract. There's four of them in the game, so you're playing the shooter, playing the 10 pound version of the game. There's four of them, and this is so the camera a little bit, so you have 200 units of wood, 500 units of metal, 450 from the trim, 150 from the trim, and 500. To buy out the company investor is a lot of money. You need to make roughly, probably, depending on anything from 4 billion to 8 billion. So it's all irrelevant on what your company is running. So, you know, if you go down to your company profile or something, statistics. So you go to game statistics, you go company value 16.8 million. So I don't know whether you know anything about company value and how to work that. So company value is basically on what you've got in stock and what assets you actually have. So that's buildings. So any vans, buildings, anything that is known as an asset. So that's buildings, vans, lorries, trucks, cars, trains, that sort of stuff. Actual ownership of it. And then on top, what you have value in stock itself. So say for argument's sake, you're a parcel delivery company, or let's just go into, say, you're a manufacturing company. Right? So you manufacture, say, electrical items, as we say. So if you have, say, five Arctic lorries, and you've got 7.5 ton lorries, and is it 7.5 ton? I think it is. I can't remember. If you've got Arctic lorries, they're the massive ones that basically have that pivot and thing in the middle, and they've normally got a detachable trailer to them. And then you've got the other type of lorry, which is basically all of one. If you've got, like, say, five of each of those, and then maybe a small van and bits and pieces, they're quite valuable. You're talking nearly 50 grand to even 100,000 pounds just for a 7.5 ton lorry. So, they're quite small vans. Mercedes make them. I moved in a 7.5 ton, which was made by Mercedes, and they're not that bad. I mean, they've got, But anyway, getting back to the picture, so you're a manufacturing company, your company value would be on your actual assets. So that would be my home port, so what Reykjavik is worth, plus the value of the ships. And also the stuff that's on board my ships. So at the time, obviously, what I'm transporting across the world. And that's what my company value is. And also, what assets I've got on top of my bank account. Right? So my bank account at the moment is 44.8 million. So, my company value is it's only about 18 million over what actual assets I actually have. And this menu is going to tell you, obviously, how many ships you've sold, how many ships you've got, how many games, your home port, manual docking and casting off, dock maneuvers, favourite port, how long time you've been there, contracts delivered, completed company contracts, failed company contracts, favourite freight. No idea why, but it's always been for me, post and parcels. It always has been. Well, I'm not being rude, but that is like the main item that I always send. So again, it's a no-brainer to go for Reykjavik because you get 20% extra money from it. Favorite freight contracts delivered, 11 loans taken out, one. And then you've got things like company design, colors and all that, which you can change, by the way, if you want to. But it also tells you about the company value, and that's what she's going to take the profit from. So she's going to say, my business is worth 62.8 million, so she'll take 10% of that, so she'll be charging 6.2 million per 3 months. So she'll get every 3 months, she'll take her cut of money. Which, when you think about the fact that she's only giving you 10 million to start off with, when you think that, say, she's my investor for, say, 6 years, and she's only actually given me 10 million pounds, how much money has she actually made from the company since, So when you think about things like Dragon's Den and Sharks and all that, they do make their money back. If you think about how much money Reggae Source made within its first year of being in operation, And now the fact that it's in every fucking shop and they've now got pastels and various other bits and pieces on top. Peter Jones made a lot of money out of that company. You know, and he still owns part of that company. You know, this is why if you're buying things like Dragon's Den, just make sure you get yourself a decent deal, because eventually I would want to go completely to the point where I own all of my company and nothing and don't have any. Because the problem with investors is that they're too occupied in what they want from the company and not what you want to be with it. You know, because they own such a small percentage. And these people know so many people in the business industry that they can almost make you collapse overnight. And it's quite shocking how powerful these people have actually been and how much influence they have in the world. You know, if you fall out with them over something ridiculous, they could literally shut your business down within the end of the day. Because they've got so much capital, they could probably steal your business away from you just by taking it to a courtroom. You know, and come up with some jargon bullshit that the reason why they need to take their company over. Even though they don't really own that much of a big percentage of it, they could probably do. And this is what makes me think, like, how many times do and it's what really annoys me, especially when they sit down and someone comes into the den and they say something along the lines, we're giving away 10%, and then they have the nerve and the audacity to come out with, oh, now I want 40%. It's a 40%, like, that's a big percentage of my business. That means you are going to make lots of money from the company. And then when they refuse to give you, say, even like 30% back of the company after they've made their money back, you know, and when you think about how much money they're actually putting forward, like, they're only on a small scale. This woman's giving me 10 million, she's going to make probably about a billion, maybe even 2-3 billion from the company. From a £10 million investment. Now you think Peter Jones only gave, what, 100,000? And you think how much money he's made. He's probably made, what, maybe 100 million from that investment. So, you know, to say they're not making money from it, yeah, they are. You know, Peter Jones probably made a good 200-300 million so far from what they did. If not even more, you know. And you think, like, it's not just reggae sauce that he owns either. So you think these people are on some, like, silly money. And I mean silly money. And it's the reason why things are so extravagant to pay with things. Because you get to pay an investor. You know, like, it doesn't matter whether your business makes money or not, fuck you, pay me. Remember the movie, like, oh, what's it called? Goodfellas. You know, when he said, oh yeah, I'm coming into the business, fuck you, pay me. Like, if the business doesn't make any money, well, fuck you, pay me. It's the same thing, you know, but the only difference is you've got an investor. So regardless of whether your company's missing money or not making money, you still got to pay your investor. The fact that, as far as concerned, like, that place was never really empty when I was growing up. And they did all sorts of stuff in there. I mean, like, stationery, food, clothing, games, toys, all sorts of fucking stuff. And they went bucks. It's like, how on earth would you manage to go bucks? Like, I cannot remember a day where I didn't see a lot of people in that shop. When I lived in, like, Gosport as a child, I remember buying one of my first video games from Gosport Warlocks. And To leave and we get to the door and then we'd empty our pockets and then the security couldn't really get along. And we used to every week, and then eventually they got so used to us doing it that they just left us to it. They just knew that we were just going to get to the front door and just drop everything on the floor and walk out. We were kids, that's the same. I was in work, I was probably at 12, 13 at the time. It soon got boring though, really good. Yeah. First video to do a few different coping first. Yeah, I'm going to video down, then I'm going to go eat, and then I may make the next video, or I may get that smoke away. I don't know yet, but we'll see. Unfortunately, I've got a couple of weeks where I'm going to be out for the camp, and we'll spend in 3 weeks in this, but we haven't perceived them. And a couple of time I'm working on, it's going to be about 3 weeks. So, unfortunately, I'm spending Christmas morning in the hospital. It's going to be quite tough because I'm not going to really get any of that properly, but at least they're going to take it on properly. So, that's right, I'm looking forward to my year being completely acid reflux fit. So, I shouldn't be really suffer with it again. And hopefully by that point I'll be able to eat food normally again, and I won't be suffering as much as I am now. But at the moment I'm working, I can't really eat it. But it hurts too fucking much for both of them. Which is quite annoying for me because I do like my food. And unfortunately I've not been able to eat chocolate for the best part of the whole year, which has been probably the hardest thing I've ever got to do. When I look back and think I used to munch 4 bars of chocolate probably a day, and I haven't had one now properly since February this year. So I think the last time I actually ate a 4 bar of chocolate to myself was before February 1st. So I'm going to rather enjoy tucking into a bar of Galaxy chocolate, I think. Whether it be Galaxy, it might be the Bourneville. I'm not entirely sure whether it be Bourneville or Galaxy. It could be dark chocolate rather than Galaxy. I don't know. Thank you. Basically, I've got a massive ego problem. I've been putting on these tablets that basically make me fart for England. I can pretty much feel the best part of the Eastern Seaboard in the farts. I mean, it's unreal. Oh, it's fucking horrible. I hate it. I really do, just hate it. So I'm going to buy another party because I can. And it's not going to take me long to get my name back on it. So, gives me enough time to make my money back this month. I've now got my second bike in, so I'm now able to pick up twice as many goods. So I should make even more money now. But the problem is, obviously, my company value has now gone up. So, you know, remember when I was only on about 62 or 64, and now I'm 84. So, yeah, just take into consideration every time you buy a ship. Left of this handover, so we've done the network and the machinery. We've only got a little bit of wood left, and then we've got electronics and furnishings. Furnishings are already on the way, so we've only really got electronics to do. So hopefully, we'll get luck. And I know I'm stupid for smoking a glass of beer. There we are. 9.6 million. So that's what she's going to charge me at the moment. 9.6 million. Which when you think about it, at the moment is putting me in debt of 3.4 million. Thank you. fully because I've got the money for it. So why not? Especially when you pick up contracts that are worth money. Like obviously in this game they're going to be worth quite a lot because to be blunt, everything probably got a stupid amount of money. Once you've completed the handover, the whole map opens up as well. So that even once that opens up, you have the full map available to you. And that will be part two of the video. So the part two is going to be basically opening up the contract, opening up the locations, and obviously starting to get the St. Petersburg order finished. That may continue to a video three to complete the order. And then we'll possibly do the next rank by that point as well. So we'll start getting all of that. Oh no, no, we won't be opening it up because we haven't got our ships yet. So in order for us to basically open up the full map, we need to buy our first two battleships. So as long as we don't buy a second class ship, we don't open the rest of the map. So the idea being is I want to buy a lot of bulkers before I do that. That means I'll be building quite a bigger capital because I have quite a fair few ships. But to be blunt, I really want to open up the map. So what I may do is I may buy a second class ship, so just so I can start opening up the sites. But it will get expensive quite quickly once you open up the map, because obviously you need to buy subsidiaries. And I would recommend that you get at least four subsidiaries. I normally have Reykjavik as a one star, and then the rest of them are like, I normally go for Georgia ports or New York. I go Santos. I normally pick one in China. I always go Gabang, because that's a good location as well. And I normally go for one in Australia as well. But it doesn't really matter, but I would strongly recommend that you pick like five star ports so that you can have all ships available to you rather than having just little tiny ports. The little tiny ports are not really worth the money to get. At this point in the game they are, because obviously we're not that far up the ranks, but to be fair, you want to be getting bigger ports because obviously you'll have more ships available to you. But there's no point buying a subsidiary and having to sell it and then only getting half your money back and then having to buy a larger cost. So you might as well just go for a bigger expense at first and then you never have to sell it more. It's just a no-brainer. And obviously with the rank, this rank I need to have two subsidiaries, so you're talking about even more. And obviously you've got to buy the two-star ship, which is a permanent ship.
obviously we've got to complete the next rank first before we do that. So in order to do that, we need to have two subsidiaries extra. And then obviously complete three contracts, we need one ship. Okay, we're not going to actually be able to do that then. Okay, that's really weird. It might be because the ship's not available. Oh no, it's not going to be available because it only fucking subsidiary, we can have this actual one class subsidiary. So, excuse me. Idiot. So I may go for England as well, so I may go for one in Europe, which would possibly be then I have one, two, three, four, yeah, that's fine. So one in China, which would probably be Shanghai, might be Hong Kong, I'm not sure yet, we'll see which one we get unlocked. Santos is definitely one, the band's worth it, the Georgia Ports are one of the band. So, I normally pick Georgia Ports to be fair, because there's a mission for Georgia Ports, so we may well have Georgia Ports. So, we do have quite a fair bit of capital, but not really enough that we can make 40 million back on. So we may want to wait until we get another bulk before we consider doing it. Because when we So I can actually bring this video down now, so I'm going to probably save it. So if I just save the game as episode 1, so and that's it. So basically this is episode 1 of the guide, and then I'm going to go through the rest of the game with it. So once again we're going to come back and I'll probably do episode 2, which is where we're going to basically build our fleet of ships and two starships. And then we'll go from there. I'm probably going to end up doing my Sniper 5 video tomorrow, and then I'll probably cover the rest of this in the afternoon. So I'm going to try and get it all done really by the time I go down for my operation next week. So if I don't, you have to look there with me. So I'm going to dash off quickly, but I'll see you in the next video. Cheers, guys.